12 hours after the premiere of The Mummy, which we covered a while back, links in the description, Stephen Sommers received a call from Ron Meyer, the president and CEO of Universal Pictures. In addition to delivering words of congratulations, Meyer invited him to come back and direct the sequel. They anticipated The Mummy would be a massive hit, and it was.
By the time we finished making Mummy 1, I had all these ideas, and I thought, oh, wouldn't it be great to make a sequel? Because it needed to be a new adventure, a new story, new special effects. You know, I didn't want to rely on old tricks. I had to, you know, take it to a whole new level, make it, you know, not only bigger, but try to make it much better.
The Sommers got to work and envisioned a larger story that fleshed out the mythology, took our heroes around the world, and featured next-generation visual effects. The sequel required more of the crew, who had to construct many elaborate sets, and the cast, who joined them in the rigorous shoot.
The key is to first get the cast back. And that's what I felt really good about, because Brendan and Rachel and John and myself, we all agreed, let's not do the sequel unless it's going to be better.
Action! Set a few years later, the O'Connells have a young son, Alex, and are prophetically tied to the mythology. The story also featured a new villain, Dwayne The Rock Johnson's The Scorpion King, in addition to Imhotep and his legion of monstrosities.
I'm directing The Rock. For me, actually, the real key was when we sent it to The Rock. You know, he doesn't have to do this movie. He's got many things on his plate. But he read the script and said, oh, I want to play this part. This will be fun. And then I knew we really had something.
Filming began in May of 2000 and wrapped up in September. The five-month shoot took place in Morocco, Jordan, and London, and was challenging on the cast and crew. From the scorching desert heat, multiple injuries on set, including a few that nearly crippled Brendan Fraser, to bouts of food poisoning that almost brought down The Rock.
We shot from Marrakesh, way out in the Sahara Desert. And now we're shooting also in Jordan, and some in Egypt, so we're getting around.
While The Mummy was supported by practical effects and had some amazing CGI for the time, the sequel employed more CGI to bring the creatures, locations, and set pieces to life. The technological leap in the 2 years between the films enabled them to do things that they had only dreamed of in the past, and some things they perhaps should not have dreamt up at all. In the year 3067 BC, Matthias of Akkad, a deadly warrior tempered by war, leads an army to conquer the world. After taking most of Egypt, his army was defeated at the city of Thebes, and he was exiled. Vowing to give Anubis his soul in return for the power to defeat his enemies, he's rewarded with command of the army of Anubis. But after the deed is done, Anubis returned the army back to the underworld and transformed Matthias into a monster condemned to serve him for all of time.
Hammer and chisel. Alright, let's do it your way.
Jumping ahead to 1933, Rick O'Connell explores the ruins of Egypt with his wife Evelyn and son Alex, discovering the bracelet of Anubis.
The bracelet of Anubis.
In a disastrous move, Alex puts the bracelet on, which locks onto his wrist and shows him the site of the Scorpion King's final battle. This kicks things into motion, with Evelyn soon abducted by a cult that want to bring back Imhotep and help him take control of the army of Anubis, forcing the family to follow in desperate pursuit.
You know, a couple of years ago, this would have seemed really strange to me.
Joined by Ardith Bey, they locate and free Evelyn, but Alex is kidnapped in turn. With the cult using the bracelet to find Amshir, the gang and old friend Izzy Buttons give chase in his hot air balloon, aided by clues Alex leaves them. Anaxunamun is also brought back from the dead in the body of Mila, the physical reincarnation of Imhotep's long-lost love. The process also somehow awakens memories in Evelyn, who happens to be the physical reincarnation of Princess Nefertiti, her nemesis.
Only the journey is written, not the destination. How else do you explain Evie's visions? My friend, there is a fine line between coincidence and fate.
The O'Connells and the Magi arrive just in time to safely remove the bracelet from Alex's wrist without killing him, but are caught off guard by the cult, who kill Evelyn before using the bracelet to summon the army of Anubis. Fueled by rage, Rick attacks the now mortal Imhotep as the Scorpion King enters the chamber. Luckily, Alex and his uncle are able to resurrect Evelyn, who fights Anaxunamun as Rick kills the Scorpion King and returns his army to the underworld with Jonathan's magical scepter. While Evelyn risks her life to save Rick, Imhotep is abandoned. Shocked and heartbroken, he willingly casts himself into the chasm, only for Anaxunamun to accidentally fall into a pit of flesh-eating scarabs.
Congratulations, you played yourself.
The gang ultimately escape the crumbling pyramid with the help of Izzy, but not before Jonathan steals the crystal jewel, of course.
O'Connell, who the hell have you been messing with this time, huh?
Oh, you know the usual. Mummies, pygmies, big bugs.
The film expands on the daring adventures of the original, and ups the ante with its set pieces, but with its rapid speed, it feels less concerned with characters and more focused on the visual spectacle. Still, Fraser and Weiser's chemistry is undeniable. Their characters have matured beyond the flirtatious bickering that brought them together in the first film, and you very much believe that they are in love. Along with John Hannah, Oded Furr, and Arnold Vosloo, they help keep this thing from going off the rails.
It's just an oasis.
What's a catch?
Supposedly it's the resting place of Anubis' army.
Yeah, you see? I knew there's a catch. There's always a catch!
However, much of the humor and wit of the first has also been reduced in favor of constructing terror, but with the limited use of the mummy itself, the potential horror is diluted, and that's probably my biggest gripe. Vosloo's eponymous Imhotep is only present sporadically throughout the film, and uses his powers even more infrequently. The film tries to inject a sense of urgency in the narrative, with everyone needing to reach the oasis before the bracelet kills Alex, but that isn't translated so well in scenes that make it feel as though we're leisurely traveling from location to location. The original Mummy had a sense of apocalyptic levels of doom, with characters contending with the potential end of the world. That is so much more engaging than a race against time to save a kid that we barely know. Sure, the bracelet is a means of getting control of the army of Anubis, which could be used to end the world, but that doesn't have as much weight as the threat of the godlike Imhotep in the original. It's basically Armageddon by proxy. Certain effects like the army of Anubis and the pygmy mummies are still impressive, but the cracks in the over-reliance on CGI begin to show in the final battle. The Wall of Water is a nice callback to the Wall of Sand in the original, but it also felt like they were running out of ideas. Because of the CGI heavy scenes, it was also harder to buy into some of the ridiculous action sequences. As amazing as the set pieces were, it never felt as though our characters were in danger.
This is bad, Amy!
We've had bad before!
This is worse!
Alan Silvestri's score is perfect, vacillating between epic Egyptian themes and upbeat adventure, encapsulating the same blend of Boris Karloff's The Mummy with Indiana Jones that the original mastered.
The failure rate, I'm told, is like 80%. Only 20% of sequels do better than the first ones. So, you know, we've got the odds against us, but I've seen the movie and it's gonna be amazing.
Still, Imhotep is severely underutilized. He's resurrected 40 minutes in and doesn't regain his powers for some time. It just felt like they didn't know what to do with him, notable with the fact that his powers are then taken away again so he can fight like a mortal. On a technical level, the mummy did return, but he's nowhere near as scary, imposing, or relevant to the story as he was in the first movie. The edge has been smoothed out, seen clearly with Alex, who, instead of being used to show how the O'Connells have changed or to increase the stakes, feels like comic relief, used to appeal to a younger audience. Despite being held captive, you don't feel as though he's in any danger. Ironically, I saw the first two movies as a kid, and despite the fact that the second one was tailored for me, I actually preferred the horror and wit of the original. Regardless, I still love this film and would rather rewatch it than most of the crap being made these days. Also, without it, we wouldn't have gotten the epic The Scorpion King spin-off movie the very next year that was followed by four direct-to-video sequels.